I feel the waves cut through me, hypnotized by the sounds I'm breathing in. Hold tight.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and everyone I have missed, with a statement and with my heart, today I have a very special stream for you, and I want everyone in the chat to open the URL I have in the on the top of the screen, editor.p5js.org. I want everyone to participate. Everyone to do this because you have to type, you have to write to get something in your head. Okay, what I've planned for today is I want to program with you a little game, and the game will be Pong. Just very simple Pong, and it will be done in P5.js. It's a JavaScript framework. JavaScript is a programming language that is in every browser. So you don't have to install any plugin, you don't have to install any compiler. If I'm using any scary word, please type in chat. Scary word, then I will have to explain it. Okay. Are the sound levels okay? Is the music too loud? Is the music okay? Music is just for filling the voids and not really for anything else. And I have to get my notes here. Okay, chat is there. Okay, I think I have everything. Okay, yeah. Follow along on editor. You don't need any music. Okay, but the music is there. So it's maybe it's too low, but music is there. Okay. Like I said, go to editor.p5js.org. Ask questions if you have any questions, and just type along, follow along what I'm doing. And this won't be the most efficient or the most beautiful code. This will be just for educational purposes. So I'm doing stuff very manually. I don't use every language feature or every feature of the framework, so you don't get confused. And very important, I'm not an expert in P5.js. I actually just picked up the framework just for the stream. So last Tuesday when I tried it out. And yeah, as learning objectives for the stream is not how to use P5.js and not how to write JavaScript specifically. I just want to teach you how to tackle problems like a programmer and how to learn a programming language and library. So you can go after the stream, you can go on your own and learn stuff on your own. And I'm going to teach you the basics of programming, specifically this this type of programming. And we don't have a rubber duck, but I have enough plushies. If you don't have a rubber duck, even better, just tell me your problem. And I'm gonna help you even better than a rubber duck. I'm gonna teach you how to write code that spits out an image, how to make the image move, and how to use a very simple logic to make the image interact, basically. So, yeah, basic programming tools, functions, here, scary words, attention, functions, variables, if conditions, and logic. Logic in terms of comparisons and okay, and this will everything be done on a Pong example. Good. Before we rewrite any line of code, I know this is a big preface. The game will be actually playable. Yes, you can play this game. I thought about adding a scary word feature to the bot, and when you typed scary word, I would hear a scream, but I didn't have any time to implement it. That was the plan. I'm going to start at the very, very, very bottom. So we have to know, what are pixels? Pixels are just colored dots that your monitor can display. And pixels in an image are just colored dots that are saved as an image. And this image tells your computer how they are displayed. So, what is a canvas? Canvas in quotation marks. Canvas is a feature of your browser to allow you to draw. or to allow you to write code that draws in quotations. So you will be learning how to draw pixels on a canvas. And another important thing is how color is represented. And now we are going to the sketch.js, this stuff here, the default stuff that was already put in your sketch. This is the color value of the background. It may be a bit confusing, but if you press play, you get this whitish square. If you hit auto refresh and change this value to 160, the square does get a bit darker because this is just basically a gray value from 0, which means black, to 255, which means white. Yeah, you will learn how to draw thingies by yourself. That's what I want to teach you. Exactly. And now you can already, and it's important that you just try stuff out. So this create canvas here, 400, 400, what could this mean? I'm gonna just change the second value. Oh, now it's taller. So this is the width and the height of the canvas. As we are doing Pong, we just change it to black, and 400 height is fine, and we do a little bit wider, so we have a little bit wider screen, so the second player has a bit more time to react. Good. Now these other words that you can see here. Function, setup. What does that mean? A function is just something you or another person or another code can call. Calling a function is like this. Defining a function, or it's harder than you thought. Defining a function is done with a keyboard function, keyword function, and the setup function. This is one thing you have to know. The setup function is called once, and the draw function is called once every frame. So the background is actually not drawn once. It's actually drawn once every frame. So 60 times per second, or 85 times, or 100 times, depending on your monitor. So the setup function is called once because we just have to create the canvas once. But the draw function is called 60 times per second because we have to refresh the background because we want to draw on the background and not have to deal with the image that was before. Good. These are functions that are defined by the framework. So background is functioned by the framework. I didn't explain what framework is. A framework is a collection of functions you can call, and also in this case something that's around your code. So something calls this stuff, as I said, once per frame. Okay. Can anyone follow? Did I lose anyone? This is just the basic stuff. I have to build myself up from here. Okay. Mew is with us. Viscount is with us. Seth is with us. Okay. Good. I have explained, at least in basic terms, what are functions. The stuff that goes in a function is called an argument, just so you have the terminology. And some functions can give us a value back. That's called a return value. I don't know if I have any... In this example, I don't... Yeah, in this example, I will use a return value, so keep that in mind for later. Good. Now, we want to draw the scenery of Pong. And for that, we check the P5.js reference. This is your... It's actually under p5js.org/reference. I'm gonna put it in chat. One moment. Okay. Every time you want to learn programming, you have to check the reference, or you have to know what can I do with this. So check the reference, or maybe it's called API documentation. This time it's called the reference. And these are all the functions the P5.js allows us to do. We have 3D stuff, so we can 3D later. We have 2D primitives, which will be used, which we will be using, and we have color stuff, which we can use. I can show you. It's optional in this case because we will draw white on black. We have constants, which aren't important for us, and a bunch of environment stuff. And we will be using no loop later. Okay, so this is when you get lost, when you want to know what can I do. This is the first stop for you. So we will be needing rect. I'm opening this in a tab. We will be needing ellipse. And we can check the background function, because we've already seen that. We can check what can it do, what we didn't infer from the trying it out. Okay, first background. Background 51, that's how we used it. Grayscale integer value, or integer, scary word. Integer is a whole number, not a decimal, not a number with a comma in it, or a dot, depending on your region. So it's just an integer value, and what isn't documented here, it's from 0 to 255. The background for that is binary coding, so don't worry about that. Just know it's from 0 to 255. We programmers are weird. We count from 0, we count to 255, and okay. You can put RGB values in this. Oh, we can give a function more than one argument. So a function can behave differently depending on the number of arguments. Interesting. We can change it to HSB. I'm guessing the only one who can tell what HSB is Mew in the chat, but it's another. Yeah, I thought that Mew would be comfortable with this. We can just use words or hex values or all kinds of stuff. This is a function. You can use this function in many different ways, because it's convenient. Maybe you're used to hex values. You can use a hex value. Maybe you're used to just words. You can use a word. Maybe you are used to the RGB values. You can use that, and so on. So this is a very nice thing of the. Yeah, hue, saturation, brightness. What color? How much color? And how bright? Okay, so this is a very nice feature of the library or of the framework. You can use just one integer value to make the background a gray value. You can use multiple integer values, and so on. It's just you have the choice. You have options with just one function. Okay, rect. Draw a rectangle at location 30, 30 with a width and a height of 55. It's a bit cut off there. So 30, 20. 30, 20, 55. We can just copy this in our code and put it in the draw function. We can actually put it in the setup function just to show you what happens. And play. Nothing happens. Interesting. Why does nothing happen? Because it's setup is called first and then basically draw. So before we see anything, I can show you by moving the background up here. Now setup, background, rectangle, and draw does nothing. So this works, but if we put background down here, the background is over the, it's on top of the rectangle. So the order how we do it is important. So rect 30, 20, 50, 50. The semicolon at the end of the statement, one call of a function or one defining of a variable is called a statement. And the semicolon of the end of a statement is in JavaScript optional. So we can just write this, or we can write this, and try to be consistent. Either use it on every statement or use it on no statement. Don't mix and match because it's harder to read. And I would recommend putting the semicolon at the end, just because other languages that are similar that look similar use the semicolon at the end, and JavaScript is a bit of an outlier. So put the semicolon there, but if you forget it, it's not a big deal. Good, now we have rect, but this should look like a paddle. It doesn't look like a paddle. It should be not so wide. So I think in my code, I took paddle a width of 5. Oh, that's the height. A height of 60. A width of 5. So this is almost looks like Pong already. And we put it at 210. Okay. So maybe we want it to be centered and not. So, okay, I have to explain again. Maybe I'm doing this part. Okay, so this is our canvas. Whoops. So this is our canvas. And currently we are drawing white. I don't have white, so I didn't use purple. We are drawing a white square, and the pixels are counted from here. So this is 0, 0, not like normal regular Cartesian system. Or this is just a this is just a whiteboard, so I can draw, so I can easier show you stuff. This doesn't have to do anything with programming. This is just for me to visualize stuff for you easier. Yeah, this is just easier for me to type out stuff and show you stuff. Okay, so this here is 0. I even have a. So this is 0, 0. This pixel here. And this should be, in our case, 600, 400. Just so you know how the grid works. It's not like normal Cartesian system where this is 0, 0 and it goes this way. It actually goes this way. In other graphic libraries, it can be that 0, 0 is in the middle. Yeah, this is 0, 0. You can write it at 0 as 0, 0, or you can say x 0, y 0, and this is x 600, y 400. Okay, just to visualize it. So now we have, and now we have put the rectangle at 200, at x 10 and y 200. The bottom left would be 400, no, 0, 400. The x value is always first, like Cartesian system. This is a thing that is very consistent in math and programming. X, Y. It's always that order. So this is X, Y, width, height. I don't know why I got confused at the first try, but you can almost guess it how it works. So we draw this rectangle at x10, so this is 10 pixel from the side and 200 from the top. But maybe we want it to be in the middle. We can subtract the height of the thing. This would work. And actually we are just keeping it this way for now. Okay, I have to actually take a breath. I think I'm talking a bit fast, so I'm a bit excited. Okay. Excitement is good, yeah. I will be trying to use it. Okay, we have read the documentation for background, we have read the documentation for rect, and we actually you can try it. Maybe I give you some time. Try to draw the right paddle. Don't look at what I'm doing, just try to do it by yourself. Okay. I hope this was enough time. But what you just had to do is copy this, copy the line, and change the y value, because we just want to have the same thing on the same height as the x value. Sorry. Yeah, you did it. You programmed your own thing. You did it. You made it. You can go home now. No. The thing is, what I've tried to tell you earlier, it's a bit inconvenient that we have to do the 585 here, because 590, it always draws at the top left also. So it draws from here to here. And this time we want to draw from here to here. So we have to subtract 5 more, because the whole thing has a width of 5. In a moment, maybe in 10, 20 minutes, I will show you how to make this a bit easier. Oh yeah, even I was confused when I did it first, but that's why it works this way. It has to begin drawing somewhere, and that's why many graphic libraries try to draw it from the center, because it's more intuitive. But this one does you can change it, but I think it's easier to understand this way first. Okay, now we have two rectangles, and we have also the ellipse function, and it looks very similar. And it is actually similar. It is x, y, width, and the height is optional. So we can omit the height and have a circle. So we can do ellipse, and we will be having, we will be putting it in the middle, so like 300, 400, and it will be 300, 200, sorry, and it will be like maybe 10. Yeah, that looks about right. Again, this isn't exactly in the middle, because we would have to do 195 and 295, because we have to subtract half of the width and the height of the of the circle. So now it's exactly in the middle. Okay, now it already looks like Pong. Just with a few lines of code, we've already drawn an image that looks like Pong. That was easy, and I explained way more than I should have. Yeah, okay, you can have four numbers, because it's an ellipse, not a... an ellipse has two... has a width and a height, like the rectangle. So I can put 20 here, and it will be higher. Or I can put 30 here, and it will be even higher. So that's why you have four numbers. But if you omit the last value, it just assumes you want to have a circle and not an ellipse, and it takes the same height as the width. Okay? Alright, so now we have drawn, yeah, you got it, right, good. Now we've drawn our image, and this looks good, but we want to have it animated. And for that, I'll have to introduce you to variables, and we have to define functions of our own. We've already defined the setup and this draw function, but that was because the framework did it for us. To define a variable, we can use the let keyword. So we can use let, and then a name, we can choose whatever. Try to use lowercase letters and what's called camel case. Camel case is when you do when you're doing this background and then color and then equals zero. So camel case would be an uppercase C for the second word. This would be snake case, and it is used in some. Well, it is default in some languages, but the dominating style in JavaScript is camel case. So now we have defined background color, but we are not using it. We just said, hey, we have this thing, this background color, and it should be a zero, but we are not using it. Now we can replace this zero with background color, and it works. And now we can change this value to whatever we want, 150, to have a grayer background. So that are variables. They're called variable because we can also do something like this. Background color equals back. No, okay, no, not so fast. Background color equals 50. Okay, this is almost exactly the same as the background color. Okay, so what we've done now is we've defined a variable called background color and set it to zero, and then we overwrote the value of background color with 120. And then we used the variable in the background function. We don't have to call it background color. We can call it something totally different. We can call it var1 to make it super confusing for everyone who tries to read the code. Because var1 doesn't tell you anything. It's var1. Okay, it's a variable and it's the first variable someone defined. So you can choose whatever. You can even choose, I think you can even choose function names, but don't do that. If there's a function you want to call later and you are using a variable that's the same name, don't do that. Just try to make it unique. Okay. Back to background color. Whoops. Okay, background color, and we don't need this. Okay. Now one other thing, and this is a bit an advanced thing, but I think it's important for you to know. If you define a variable in another function. Then even if setup is called before draw, background color won't be available here. And that's because something called a scope. This variable is only available in the scope of this function. So it isn't available here. So you could use the same name in this function and use it for something completely different. That's a good thing. That's a good thing, so we don't litter our namespace. Namespace is a scary word. We don't litter the things we can type with stuff. But in this case, we can put it outside of this outside of the functions, and now I've got it. I had a problem with my window. So now we have put it outside of the functions, and now it's in the global scope. The global scope, as you can imagine, this variable is available in everything, in the whole code. We can use it in setup, we can use it in draw, we can use it in functions we have later, we can change it everywhere. So we have to keep in mind when something is called first. So if we set background color here to 20, 120, and we set background color here to 40, then because setup is called before draw, this 120 is overwritten. And if we put it after background, it will also work, because for a split second, for one frame, the background was the gray value 120, and then it was set to 240, and then draw is called again and again and again, and that's because that's why it's the 240 value again. Okay, now we know scope, we know variables, and that's nearly enough to program the whole game. Because now we can use variables for stuff like the canvas widths. So I'm defining all the stuff where I've used the numbers directly. I'm using variables now. For people knowing programming, I know there's something called constants. I will be coming to that later, but in this case, I'm using variables for this. Constants aren't in the scope of this stream. Okay, and now we can replace this with canvas width and canvas heights. Constants and variables, something Bioshock. Yeah, maybe. I think I didn't play enough Bioshock. Okay, now we have that. We can use... And now we are coming to the territory where it's a good thing we are using variables, because for the pedal width, we can use it in both these functions. I know, Metcon, normally you would try to avoid global variables because of the littering of the global namespace, but in this case it's way easier to understand with global variables. It is not a very good style, but as I said, it's easier to understand. So now we have one variable up here, and we can change the pedal width as we want for both pedals at the same time. Nice, because we used a variable. And the same thing, this is just a, how do you say it, a bit tedious and a bit unnecessary, but normally would do this from the get-go, use variables for the stuff or constants, but it was easier to do it this way. Okay, and now we can, for this position stuff, where we have these strange numbers, we can just use math. It was scary math, but we can use canvas height minus pedal height. No. Yeah, half of the canvas height minus half of the pedal height. It's even easier if we do this in another variable. For later. Let pedal y equal pedal left y equal, no, just pedal y for now. Equal this stuff, I think I've copied too much. Pedal Y. Okay. And yeah, that's good for now. For the ellipse. Oh, sorry. What am I doing? I'm defining variables to use in the code to for one thing, to make it easier to read. So we know, okay, this is a pedal, and these are the variables that make the pedal. So we can use pedal width. Okay, pedal width is 5. If we want to change the height of the pedals later, we can use 80 or 60. So we have one place where we can change that. And the pedal Y thing with a mass formula here, with a simple mass formula, this is because of the strange number we had here. We had, what was it, 170. 170 was canvas height, the half of the canvas height, 200, and half of the pedal height, 60, half 60 is 30, minus is 170. And that's because the rectangle is drawn from the top left always, but we want it to be centered. All right? I think we will do the same for the ball, so we have it out of the way. Ball. Okay, you got it. Ball Y equals, for now, I'm doing this with a full number. Yeah, ball Y. Oh, I'm because I know what error messages the program or the browser will throw JavaScript. I'm always ignoring those, but you shouldn't ignore those. Those are important. So, uncaught syntax error. Identifier ball Y has already been declared. Sketch line 8. So this is telling us where the error was thrown. Line 8. And ball Y has already been declared. We already used the variable here, and we can only use let for a variable once. If we want to overwrite it later, we can't use let. We have to just write ball y equals 195. But in this case, we want to define the x of the ball. And don't forget to actually use it in your code. X. Y. Yeah, and I switched those, sorry. Okay. So we've done a whole lot and nothing really changed because we just defined variables for the parameters we are using. But this is actually a good thing because because these in particular, pedal Y, ball X and ball Y, are the values that will be changing. I think it would have been maybe a bit easier to understand if I just... Okay. Have a good day. Thanks for watching. Thanks for the questions. And check out the VOD. Yeah, that's a good idea. See you later. Bye. Okay, these are the values that will be changing. Maybe it would have been easier for you if I just defined variables for the things that will be actually changing. But I like to have the code a bit cleaner, so I defined variables for stuff like the width and the height that won't be changing in the game. Okay. Okay, you're with me. That's good. I'm just breathing a little bit because let that sink in a bit. Okay. Good. Now we can make things move. Now it gets interesting. So, if we want things to be moving, we have to change the variables that are used here. So we want the ball to be moving to the right, let's say. So we can just write ball x equals, and then we can use the variable for setting the variable. So we can use ball x again plus 2, and now it's moving because ball x is overwritten with the value of ball x plus 2. So it's increasing by 2 every time, every frame. So just press play again and the ball is moving. Pretty cool. Okay. So one more time, press x. Press the play button and it's moving. Great. But that isn't really what we want, because it's not a game, it's just a ball that's phasing through the pedal. And we actually want the... this 2 is also a thing we want to have a variable. And I'm calling this velocity. Okay, so I just used the variable for the velocity, and the velocity is 2 pixels per frame currently. Good. And next, we want to make the ball pong off the pedals. And I'm going back to my whiteboard and to this. Okay, I have 3 for this one, but this is the thing I prepared earlier. Again, our canvas, our 2 pedals, our ball. In this case, I wrote 3 pixels per frame, but we have 2 pixels per frame. And this is the ball when it should be bouncing off the right pedal. So we have these are the variables that are important for us, ball x, in this case 200, in this case something like, I don't know, something close to the pedal. And I should have extracted the variable for the right pedal. This is wrong, this should be 385. That's the right pedal value we used. 585, sorry, that's even. So, 585. This is the value we used here. Okay, and now if we just want to declare what should happen in plain English, we are saying if the x position of the ball is greater than the x position of the right pedal, then reverse the velocity of the ball. Because a bounce is just reversing the velocity to the other side. So if the x position of the ball is greater than the x position of the right pedal, then reverse the velocity of the ball. So we should use more variables for the right pedal x equals 585 and for good measure left pedal x equals 10 and then actually use these in our code. Okay, so now we can just write what I just said. If, and now we have to use brackets, ball x, the x position of the ball is greater, so we use the greater than symbol, greater than right pedal x, the x position of the right pedal, and now we have to use these squirrely brackets, which are also used for the function. Where are the squirrelies? Oh no! I'm using a... Why isn't... I'm just copying these. I'm used to using a Mac, so the keys are different. So, okay. Now, if the x position of the ball is greater than the x position of the right pedal, then we want the velocity to be reversed. So, velocity equals minus velocity. Bong! You can even add sound later, but I don't have sound for now. So now, as you can see, the ball, pong, pongs off the pedal, just as we wanted, with just three lines of code. Very nice. We can just copy this and use it for the left pedal. If the x position of the ball is less than the left x position of the left pedal, then we reverse the velocity again. Pong. As you can see, the ball actually phases into the pedal a bit, and that's because again how we've drawn it from the top left. So if we don't want that to happen, we have to add the pedal width to this. But that's just cosmetic in this case. We don't, it's just, yeah. This is just cosmetic. I'm actually removing it because it's easier to understand as we've written it now. Okay. So now we have logic. We have comparison, if conditions, and logic. Okay, and now a little bit of a shortcut. You can see these two if conditions are doing the same thing. Both are reversing the velocity. If you would explain this in plain English, you would say if this or if this reverse the velocity. And the OR symbol in programming are these things, these pipes, these ALT and the greater than symbol in Windows. And now we can do this in one condition. So if this happens or this happens, reverse the velocity. So is everyone with us so far? we've done very much in 1 hour, and we are very close. No, not really, but we have something. You have an error you don't understand. Very good. What is the error? I'm going to help you. Maybe other people also have that error. That's what I'm here for. Unexpected end of input, line 31. Okay, you have a square, you seem to have a curly bracket. You've forgotten a curly bracket. One of these things. Look if they are matching up. You have to have exactly the same number of opening and closing ones. So this is opening here, it's closing here. This is opening here, it's closing here. This is opening here, it's closing here. So unexpected end of input means he tried to understand the code, but he ran into a line where there should be something, but there isn't something. So he expected something, he expected input, but it ended. And you fixed it. Okay, great. Very good. That's why I wanted an audience for this, because of this, because of questions, because of errors. I want errors. I want to help you. Okay. So now the ball is bouncing back and forth for everyone. Good. Okay, next up is moving the pedals, I think. I think we can deal with moving the pedals. For that, we have to check the reference again. So, reference, what do we want to do? We want something to happen. We want to listen for an event. Okay, it's not intuitive if you haven't programmed yet, but I know events means something like flipping your device, if it's a mobile device, or these accelerometer values, or mouse input, touch input, or button presses. And that's what we want. So we have key is pressed. Key code is important for us later. Key pressed, key released, key typed, key is down. And we want to use key is down because we want to be able to hold down the button. So we open the vertical lines. Which vertical lines? Oh, these things. It's Alt and the greater less than symbol, the same button in Windows at least, or maybe it's Alt-GR, Alt-Graph. I can put you some in chat, you can copy those. But I'm guessing here's a Dutch keyboard layout, but okay, maybe I should check what. Dutch keyboard layout pipe. Okay, that's Windows. See here, this button. Alt-Graph and this button. Yeah, I'm having macOS with Bootcamp and strange keyboard layout, so I'm not really the best for helping you. You got it. Good. Okay, you got it. Great. Yeah. We have the reference for key is down. Okay, we have key is down, left arrow. These in caps lock written are global constants. We have a global constant for each of the arrow buttons, but we don't have a global constant for each of the buttons. And that's why we also need key code. Key code. Your ball is spacing out. Did you put the velocity too high? Can you put your code on pastebin and then create a new paste and then give me the link and we can look at it together? I think that's a good way to debug it. So I've saved my version for now. Also, it's very funny to see these bugs from time to time. Yeah, while you are doing that, okay. Now I should wait. Yeah, we are very close. I think we can do it in the rest of the time. So we have time. We can breathe a bit, maybe read the. Great. All right. So it's vibrating basically. It's changing the velocity every time, every frame. Ball X is less than right pedal X, or ball X is greater than left pedal X. Right pedal X. Oh, you for one, you forgot to set these, but that isn't the problem here. Maybe I forgot that too. And you have you flipped the condition. When the X is less than the right pedal. So this is the right pedal, and it is less than the right pedal. Or if it's greater than the left pedal, the left pedal, it is greater than the left pedal, then change the velocity. So you have to change these around. Yeah, don't be ashamed. I do that all the time. Flipping conditions is easy to get confused by what is true, what is false, which way around. So that happens all the time. Okay, back to my stuff. Actually, when I programmed this on Tuesday, I did the exact same thing. The ball was vibrating in place, so it happens to me every time. Good. So ball is ping-ponging back and forth, and we want to be able to we want to be able to move the pedal. So if key down, up, arrow. So as we've seen in the reference, for key is down, not for key down, key is down. I'm just gonna copy these because I'm okay. Key is down, and the description is: the key is down function checks if the key is currently down, for example pressed. It can be used if you have an object that moves and you want several keys to be able to affect its behavior simultaneously, such as moving a sprite diagonally. You can put it key is down. Okay, I was too fast. So in the reference, you have these categories, and under events, you have all these things like acceleration. Like you can check if the phone is in a specific rotation, or if the phone is in landscape or in portrait mode. But you can also check if a key is pressed, or if a mouse is moved, or if touch is used. So this is key is down. Yeah. Also, functions are always lowercase first. The first letter is lowercase. That's a convention in almost every programming language. So if you are defining functions, use lowercase letter first. I mean, just because you used the uppercase the K in your question. I felt like I have to. Okay, if key is down, up arrow. Then we want to in this case I haven't I haven't split up the variable pedal y for the two pedals. So currently we have we will be moving both pedals, and the up arrow should be minus. So key is down, up arrow, pedal y equals minus 3. Equals pedal y minus 3. So to use the keys, we have to click on the game, and if we press up, we're moving up. And up and up and up and up and up. But the ball is still bouncing back and forth. That's expected behavior for now. So we are just gonna do the same for the down arrow, so we can come back down. Okay, and now we can click on the game and then use up and down to move for now both pedals. So now we have user input. Great. User input, ball is bouncing, everything is moving, but no game is taking place. Okay, so now we have to split these variables up a bit. So, pedal Y. You have to copy this. Whoops. And make a left pedal Y and right pedal Y. At first, they will be the same. Initially. Left pedal Y, right pedal Y. So we have to change it in our use here. And I have a typo here up here. Okay, so now I've duplicated the pedal Y variable, changed the name in left pedal Y and right pedal Y, and used it for the right and the left pedal, so we can change these values independently from each other. So the up and down arrow are doing nothing here. Interesting. The JavaScript didn't warn us when we executed the code that pedal Y isn't even defined. Only when we use it, it will throw an error and the whole thing will freeze. This isn't... in other programming languages, this would be an error when compiling, so when translating the game into machine code. This would be an error then, but JavaScript is so simple, it doesn't have that. So it can only detect the error when it encounters the problem and not before. And this guy's we want the right pedal and down here, right pedal. Okay, and now we can use up and down only for the right pedal. So, is everyone with me? So I think you know what I'm expecting you to do now, and that is do the same for the left pedal. A little hint. You're a little behind. That's not good, because it's hard to understand if you're still writing code. So I'm waiting for you. What can I do while I do that? I can make the music a bit louder and drink a little bit of water. Okay, great. So now we can move the right pedal with our arrow keys. I want you to do the same for the left pedal. And as a hint, the key for... I was using Q and A. The key codes for Q and A are... I'm typing it in chat. One moment. Q equals 81 and A equals 65. So instead of the constants up arrow and down arrow, you have to use 81 and 65. And that's because, of course, you can't just use Q as a constant, because that would be super confusing. And defining a constant for every key is also not viable. So they just defined a constant for up arrow and down arrow. and for the whole keyboard, for the rest of the keyboard, they have... you have to click into the game. You have to start the game and then click on the canvas once, and then you can move, hopefully. If it still doesn't work, again, pastebin me the code and I will have a look at it. It works. Great. Yeah, now try to do the same with the left pedal. The Q button has a key code 81 and the A button has a key code 65. That are the keys I used. You can use different keys, but you have to find out which key codes correspond to those buttons. I'm doing it quietly on my own and giving you a bit of time to try it out yourself. Oh, sorry. I know people don't like when you crack your bones, but my fingers are a bit tired. I don't know how loud it was with the microphone. I did it right in front of the microphone. I'm so sorry. Okay, it was okay. Metcon, can you follow? Am I too fast? Am I too slow? Did you already do the left pedal? Did you already complete the whole game? Yeah, you did it. Great. Okay. You're with me. Great. Good. Pedals are moving. Ball is bouncing. And yes, now we have to do the gameplay bit. The more complex gameplay bit. So it's a bit unfortunate that this comes at the tail end of the stream, because it's it gets a tiny bit complicated, but not very much. It's okay. You use shorter variable names. I like to use expressive variable names. Some people use shorter variable names. Scoreboards. Yeah. You can extend the game like you want. You can add sounds, you can make it 3D, you can add scoreboards, you can do whatever we want. The finished game will just end and say down here in the console, left player wins or right player wins. That's the end from me, but you can edit and expand it and do whatever you want. I encourage you even to. Just try out, play with the code, play with your game. Play your game, play with your game, change your game, mod your game, make it your own. But for now, we will be defining a fresh function. So outside of the draw and setup function, we will be defining our own function. and we will be calling it. I should really learn where the dumb curly brackets are. Hey, I've got him. Okay. And we will call this function ball hit paddle. Normally we would call it something like did ball hit paddle or is ball hit paddle or is ball hit by paddle. Ball hit paddle. It will be returning either true or false. So we can use it in an if condition. So these comparisons will be returning true or false. And if the if statement will execute this stuff when the condition is true and will skip the stuff when the condition is false. So ball hit paddle. Yep, oh gut. So ball hit paddle. You can comment your code with a double slash. And I will use this here. So ball hit paddle left paddle first. The comments won't be executed, they are just for you to understand your code better. You can type whatever you want, you can write whole novels if you want, but short lines are preferred. So left pedal and right pedal, and down here we have ball or I don't know, left pedal, right pedal, no pedal. Comment. Good. Okay. I think I'm going back to this thing. We have the condition for the x axis, and now we need the condition for the y axis. So if this paddle is down here and the ball is up here, it shouldn't bounce back. So if we are trying to write it in plain English, so we have which variables do we have? We have for the left pedal y. In this case it's something like, don't know, 200, let's say 200. And we have the ball y, it's 190. And it's important that we also have the left paddle height, which is 60, for example. And yeah, that should be enough. Good. And now our condition. If the x position of the y position of the ball is less than the y position of the left pedal, but not really the y position of the left pedal, because the y position of the left pedal is up here. If you remember, the thing is drawn from here, so this is the point where we have where the Y position is. And now we have to add half of the height of the pedal. No, wait. No. The full height. Oh, why did I... Sorry, one moment. Oh, in my code I did it even more complex in my example. Okay, it's even easier. Okay, if it's less than the Y position of the left pedal, or greater than the Y position plus the height of the left pedal. Sorry. Yeah, exactly. It's a between statement. It should be between, but there isn't a between. There isn't a between definition, between function. So we should determine if it's between here and here. And I switch the things. So it should be greater than this, and or less, and less than that. If it's greater than this and less than this, it's exactly between this. Okay, this is why I like to do this visually and speak out loud the conditions, because as I said, I get confused all the time. So, if the Y position of the ball is... No, it shouldn't be minus, because the Y axis is from top to bottom. So, it's... This is 200, and this is 260 down here. And this is 400. So, it's from top to bottom. But good question. You have to check it in your head again and again to make sure you have the right. So, left pedal. If ball Y good is greater than left pedal Y and ball Y is less than left pedal Y plus pedal height, and I need the squirrely brackets again. There they are. Return true. Then it hit a pedal. It also hit a pedal. It only hit a pedal when it's in this area. It doesn't hit a pedal when it's somewhere here, but also on the right y-axis. It has to be on this where right now where it's bouncing. That's when we should check it. So the ball x lower than this should also be added to the condition, and this one. So if the x position is here, left pedal, if the x position is here and the y position is matching up with the, is between here and here. So if the x position is here or less, and as the Y position is between here and here, Then we hit a pedal. And the same but different, because it's on the other side for the right pedal. Like I said, this is the most complex part of the whole program. And I'm sure maybe it can be simplified. So, for the right pedal, we have this condition here. And for the ball Y, this should be the same. Okay, and when, oh, I didn't explain return. Return just means when the function hits this statement, the rest of the statement isn't executed, and this function will return this value. So it will return true. So if we call the function, we can use it like a variable. So if ball hit pedal brackets, so we call this function, but the function is returning a boolean bool wert, so it's returning true or false. So we can use it in this if function, in this if statement. So if we move away, it should run out of the screen. On the other side, should do the same. So if we are down, yeah, it works. And if we go up, it works. And if we go down here, it works again. Great. But this still isn't Pong, because the ball is just moving on one axis. It's one plane. It's just straight back and forth. It isn't a game. You can just stay here and nobody's winning. To make this a game, the ball has to get some kind of angle. And in Pong, I don't know if this is accurate, but in Pong, oh, you are behind again. No problem. Where are you? Are you just with this this stuff, basically? Okay. Yeah, I'm just keeping this on the screen. Copy it. Maybe try to understand it later, because, like I said, this is the most complex part. If you're having questions, try to... If you're having questions now, you can ask them. If you don't even have questions, I can chat with you later. Because I think... sometimes the problem is that the stuff is too complex to even ask questions. And that's a bit of a hassle. So I hope you can either understand it or just copy it and ask me later, or ask questions now. But yeah. So I'm giving you a bit of music and I'm drinking a bit. Sorry for scrolling. I think for Metcon this is maybe a bit too low, but I hope he still you still understand how to use references, how to look up functions you want to use. If you're getting bored, maybe try to change the color of the pedals, maybe try to add sound. I know you're still watching, but if you're getting bored, maybe try to play around with the functions you are finding in the reference. So play around. That's the important bit. As a little hint, you try to unhack your variables. If you don't mind, just give me the paste bin and I'm taking a look at it. Sess, can you follow? Do you have problems? I'm only having two viewers. It's a bit concerning. Maybe Sess. Maybe Sess went away. I hope we didn't lose him. So close before the end. Oh, you're back. Great. There are just two things missing and we have the game complete. No, there are three things missing. Win condition or lose condition. Being able to angle the ball and bouncing the ball from the top and the bottom of the screen. Those are the three things, and they are very, very fast to implement. So I hope... Sess, do you need this the stuff on screen, or can I take a look at the paste bin? Oh, give me the paste bin, we take a look at it. After that we take a look at the Metcon's paste bin, and then we can add the rest of this stuff. It's really not that much. We are on the finish line, so it would be great if you can give me the paste bin. Because I've forgotten what I changed. Or is it the same paste bin? Can you even update a paste bin? No, it isn't. Well, as Seth is trying to make a paste bin, I'm checking out. Okay. Good. So this is Seth's paste bin. And... I'm saving this one. Taking a look at this one. Okay, so Ball hit pedal. Okay, and yeah, just what I did is I used the ball hit pedal in this if condition. So we only want to bounce the ball if the ball hit pedal, and now we have the problem that we get false positives. So now we have to think again about this if condition. If the Y is greater than the left pedal, and if the Y is greater than the left pedal Y, so in this direction, and is less than left pedal Y plus pedal height, so it's between this, and X is less than left pedal X, then return true. Looks right for me. If the ball is greater than the right pedal ball Y and less than right pedal plus pedal height and less than right pedal X, it is less than right pedal X because it's here. So this should be greater than right pedal X. Left pedal X, right pedal X, pedal height. Didn't lower the volume of the music. Ball X is greater than right pedal X. Right pedal X is less than. This looks fine. This looks fine. Now I'm confused. But this is also programming, just looking at your stuff, trying to understand it. This is why Metcon at the beginning said you need a rubber duck, because when you have a rubber duck, you can go through it step by step and explain it like I did to you now. No, it shouldn't be an earlier mistake, but because this behavior is this line. So it is this. Oh, this, of course, this should be a function call. So there should be brackets here. So the problem was ball hit pedal. Okay, this is a bit more complex to explain what happened here. What I did for you is that you can I switched this one around, this icon, and I added ball hit pedal in this if condition with the brackets here. The brackets mean I'm calling the function. Without the brackets, it works. Okay, great. Without the brackets, it's just if this function exists, is basically what it means. If this function exists, do this. It's not really that, but because if I hadn't defined the function here and used it here as a variable, it would say it is not defined. It's a bit different than if it's defined, but for now, that's what happened. So without the brackets, it's the same as if you were writing if true, true. So this is what happened. So ball hit pedal, and then call it, call ball hit pedal. Okay, Great. Back to my code. This one. Good. Now we are all here. And now we will add the angle, the angular momentum, angular movement of the ball. And for that, after when the ball hits a pedal, we also have to check, so we can nest if statements. We also have to check if ball y is I have to do this a bit on the fly now because my code is a bit different that I wrote beforehand. Okay, let's just define a variable here. Let left pedal middle equal left pedal y plus pedal height half. This will be easier for me because my whole code that I've prepared has a variable for the middle of the pedals. Okay, so now we have this pedal here in the middle. This is a value for that one. Oh, interesting. If you want in an output, if you want to debug with an output, you can use console.log left pedal middle, and now it should see 200. If I'm going up a bit and it hits, it's the left pedal, 179. So you can add this to check which value a variable has at a certain moment. It's I should have told you that much earlier, but that's very, very important. Good. So now I have this, that. So if left, if ball y, so if the ball hits the pedal at the top, it should bounce through to the top. It's like the pedal is curved, but they couldn't show that. But it behaves like it's curved. So the ball is behaving like this is curved like this. So this way. So if a ball comes this way, it's bounced this way. That's how Pong works. And we could actually define a hitbox, an invisible hitbox that looks like this, and then calculate the angle of entrance and calculate the angle of exit. But we don't do that. We just approximate it and fiddle with it to make it work, to make it look like it works. But you could make it very accurate with that. Okay. Okay, now we have to check if the y of the ball. Oh yeah. Now we also need a velocity of the y velocity. So this is a velocity. Just call that one velocity. I don't want to change it now, but we also have a y velocity, and this is at the start it's zero. So the y velocity is how fast the ball is moving up or down. So I'm doing a little trick here, and I'm just checking if the ball. Is less than left pedal X. So this is just checking if the ball hits the left pedal or if the ball hits the right pedal. If the ball hits the left pedal, then we will check, we will define the y velocity as left pedal middle minus ball y. So it can be negative, and we could actually run this like this. Where's the velocity stuff? Velocity. Oh, it's up here. Ball y equals ball y plus y velocity. So we can actually run it like this. So we have a positive and a negative value, and the y velocity will get a negative value. So if we hit it like this, the ball bounces downwards. That's not really what I wanted. And it's also too fast. So on my code, I have here okay. I have it like this. So the ball is going left first, and now it's bouncing right. Okay. So this is just a very, very short and very quick and dirty solution for the problem that I explained with the curved pedal and the entrance angle and the exit angle. This is just an approximation. The 6 is just guesswork by me because it felt right from the velocity. So we can use, we could actually write if ball x and check if it hits the right pedal, but we already checked if it hits the pedal, and we already checked if it hits the left pedal. So the only other solution is it hits the right pedal. So we can use else. So now, if this statement is checked, and if it's true, it will execute this code. If it's false, it will execute this code, and not vice versa. And vice versa. So it's just either or. Either it does this or it does this. And in this case, the y velocity equals right pedal middle minus ball y 6. So now it should work for both sides. wait, why is it going up even if it's in the middle? What did I do wrong? Damn it. We will check this later. For now, I want to add the bounce back from the top and the bottom, and we will check this problem later. We will debug it later. So for the bounce back at the top and the bottom, we have to check if the Y position of the ball is either less than zero or if it's bigger than the canvas height, and then we just reverse. It's the same that we did at the beginning with the left and right bounce, but for the top and the bottom. So if ball Y is less than zero, so if it's run out of the bottom of the screen, or if ball Y is bigger than the canvas height, then we will reverse the Y velocity. Minus Y velocity. So now it should bounce up and it should bounce back down. It does. Great. Can you follow me so far? I know it was very, I do this now and not very, interactive, but I feel like we've already done this with a back and forth, so this is okay. And I will look into this right after we've done the win conditions, because this doesn't feel right, and it's easier with the win conditions to debug it. So the win conditions are also very easy. If the ball runs out of the left side of the field, so the Y position of the ball is less than zero. Then we just write with the command I explained you before, console log, write wins. And then we can use, I just keep it like this. And if it is greater than canvas width, then left wins. Okay. So now left should win. Or right wins. This should be X. God, I'm also tired a bit. So if the X position of the ball is less than zero. So now, and as you can see, it just spams the console full of this stuff, and we don't want that. So we can use no loop, and that just stops the program. So the loop is a loop of the draw function, so it's called every frame, and with no loop we are stopping this. So now when it's bouncing out of the screen, it just writes one time right left wins, and that's it, and the ball stops and nothing happens. We can't even move the stuff. We have to restart the game now. Okay, so back to this one. We have to debug this and then we are done. Five. Okay, I can check it. Okay, unexpected token. You have somehow a closing bracket too much, and it is so. This one. It helps if you're being consistent with your indentation. There is a tidy code here. So if you're pressing that, it auto indents your code. So the stuff is indented, so it's yeah. It has two spaces if it's after a squarely bracket, and now you can see where the stuff is wrong. So this one should be the end of the draw function, but currently this is the end of the draw function because you forgot opening here. So tidy again, and now right petal middle. Velocity y isn't defined. It's not a function. You tried to use velocity y here as a function instead of setting the value. It's also very common to get confused, so no problem there. Okay, so I changed. I added a opening bracket here. And I changed this line to be a value assignment. The variable was assigned this value instead of calling a function that doesn't exist. And now the code is running running so far. And now you can add the bouncing from the top of the ceiling. And then we can look at the and while you are doing that, I can check the problem with the bouncing. Okay, so I was debugging it here. So it's there, and it's just 195. Ball y is 195. Or maybe you should just start at 200. I think that's what I did on my stuff. So they are just hitting the center on both sides. That was just that was it. It was this simple. So now if I'm hitting it with the bottom of my dingens, of my pedal, and left wins. You can make it easier if you're making this bigger. So now it's a bit easier, but also it should be super fast if I hit it here. Okay. Great. So what I changed is the y value of the ball. Now the problem is I'm checking with the y value of the ball. So again, the top left corner of the circle instead of the center of the circle, and I should translate all this to being the center to make it easier for me, but I'm not doing that. I didn't do it, and it's a bit confusing this way, but with this it works. And now I can get rid of this debug statement. This is the part Seth should add to make it bounce from the top and the bottom. And we are only a quarter of an hour over our time. But I think the wind thingy is this stuff. I'm really grateful for Seth, because without questions, I'm guessing if someone watches this VOD, they will have the same questions and the same problems as you. So I'm very grateful for you to be this patient and this interested in this stuff. And yeah, it would be so much more boring without you and without everyone who participated. If there is more interest in this, we can either expand this program, make a scoreboard. You can also try it on your own, add a scoreboard. We can make a totally different one. We can maybe do Space Invaders. I guess Space Invaders could be maybe a very easy version of Space Invaders. Was also easy. Tetris, maybe? Minesweeper. Minesweeper is very easy. We can do Minesweeper if you're interested in that. Tic-tac-toe, of course. And we can also expand this and add a computer component. So the opponent tries to track the ball. So yeah, just check the Discord. I'm just waiting for Seth now to scream that he did it and it works now and is totally fine and the game is working. Machine learning AI opponent. If you want to, you can do that by yourself, but I don't. Maybe if we are doing this regularly, maybe machine learning will be in about half a year. I mean, explaining machine learning alone will be super, super complex. So, but it's certainly possible to make a Pong, an AI in a neural network that plays Pong. What I would do, and then we tackle DeepMind. What I would do for a computer opponent is I would just make the speed it moves a variable. Currently it's 3 pixels per frame. And I would make it faster than the player and just try to mimic the the velocity, the trajectory of the ball. So if the ball goes down, it just moves down. And no, not the trajectory. It tries to approximate the y position of the ball. So it just tracks the y position. And if you want a harder opponent, you just increase the speed of it. And if it's super fast, you can't beat it because it's always right on top of the ball. If it's faster, then the ball can move. That would be funny. Maybe I'm doing that after the stream and putting it on the Discord. Sounds really funny. To make an impossible Pong opponent. And to add insult to injury, I can make it super short. Okay, let's look at the error. I can already see you don't have a closing bracket. Didn't I copy it? No, I did. So what is the error message? The error message is, again, unexpected end of input. So this should be a squirrely bracket. And it's still unexpected end of input because this is the end of this function. And it should be, wait, just tidy it. Yeah, this is totally normal that you get your brackets and your functions confused. So where should this function? This is okay. This is here. You missed one here after right wins. And you should also change this to 200, so it bounces straight at the first bounce. And you should also, after this one, add a no loop, so it doesn't spam the console. And then you should have it. But I appreciate you trying to do it on your own. Like I said, try to use the tidy code up here, and then just go from top to bottom and look at your brackets. Do the brackets match up where you want them to be? So, of course, now they're all matching up. But if you're clicking on one of the brackets, it shows you which closing bracket it assigns to it. That's how I found it. Also, the indentation was wrong. So you had this one missing, and the one at the bottom. So at the very bottom you had no, and at after the right wins. So okay, now I have for the up arrow, so the indentation here is wrong. Yeah, you made the game. Great. So yeah, now you have the game. I highly encourage you to play around with it. Look in the reference, look what you can do. Try to change the color of the pedals. Try to maybe first try to make the ball faster. Try to make the pedals larger. Later, try to color the pedals. Maybe add sound if you want to. If you are very ambitious, you can try to add the scoring. You can always shoot me a message on Discord and I will gladly help you out. And I think I will put this code and maybe I will comment my code. I will add comments on each line and explain everything like I did now, and we'll put it on GitHub so you can, if you have the VOD and you are too lazy to just type it all off the stream, you can just look at the GitHub code. And also if we are doing another stream and basing our next lesson on this result, we will using the GitHub version as a base. Okay, great. So yeah, like I said, I'm very glad you had time to watch me and you are interested in the stream. And half an hour earlier. Yeah, no problem. I can make it half an hour earlier. It should be half an hour shorter as well, but yeah, the length is determined by the amount of complications we have, so that's no problem. I have time, but my voice is getting my voice is getting strained right now, so okay, yeah, but I will assess the how it went. Yeah, I will check the Discord what the people who watch the VOD. Yeah, they are going off the screen. You can also change that if you want. Oh, cool. this is a cool bug. Somehow I trapped the ball. Yeah, it's normal that the pedals go off the screen. But okay, that was a cool glitch. I trapped the ball behind my pedal. Yeah. I think that was a one frame perfect trick. Because okay, cool. So if you're interested in speedrunning, that's how these glitches and one frame perfect tricks get in the games. Some programmer just is a bit lazy and yeah, holding the ball in a Pong game is really cool. Okay, cool. Yeah. Play around with the code. Shoot me your paste bins in Discord. I will let my bot do the thing. So join the Discord and oh, I think I'm getting late. So in about half an hour, maybe the spooky Halloween and January squad with Brett and Zach. So if you like spooky games, check them out. If you like Pokemon and stuff, check Wormwood Barry out. And if you like difficult games and big monsters, check Calamus out. And as always, check the Discord. Most of the time I'm there if I'm not working. So yeah, thanks so very much for watching. I hope you have a nice weekend, a rest of the weekend. I have a nice start in the week. And I hope I'll see you next time. Maybe half an hour earlier. Test successful. And also, I see you next time. Bye.